We have looked at the potential energy of a spring and then of a bar. Now let's put that together and look at the potential energy of a truss. And in this discussion, what I'll do is I'll try to keep the mathematical details as minimum as possible. What I'm using here is you can think of it as a just-in-time teaching approach. I'm trying to tell you as much as is necessary for you. So that the answer steps make sense rather than, otherwise you would be just pushing buttons and answers. So here's the truss we have, and it has three bars. And to find the potential energy of the truss, we have to add the potential energy of each of these bars and then subtract out the contribution due to the external force. And that looks like that. So that's the potential energy of the truss. And so that's potential energy of AB and then BC and AC of the three members. And then I subtract out the work done by the external force. The external force is acting in the x direction. So the work done by it is the magnitude of the force times how much pin C displaces in the x direction, which I've written as UCX. Let's take a look at how this is written. The potential energy for BC is written in terms of the pin displacements, right? So that's a key trick here, that you have to write all these the potential energy in terms of the pin displacements, because that's our primary unknown. So pi BC is going to be half KBC, as we saw previously. Based on what we saw previously. And then the extension, square of the extension of BC written in terms of the pin displacements. And I'll write the result and then I will explain it to you. So this is going to be UCY minus UBY squared. Okay? So this term in the brackets is the extension without the square, is the extension of BC in terms of the pin displacements. Now let's take a look at pin C and say, hey, you know what? What if pin C can move only in the horizontal direction? How does it affect BC? So let me draw that here. Okay, that's BC. Sorry about the chicken scratch. And let's say pin C moves in the x direction. And so the new position, if I can get it, it's something like that. Okay, and that's, you have to squint for these to look like straight lines. Obviously, this line is bigger than this, which means that B will actually get extended by a displacement perpendicular to it, but we will ignore that effect. That's a small displacement assumption. So any displacement perpendicular to a bar does not affect its potential energy, but a displacement of the pin along the bar affects it. And what is a displacement along the bar? So obviously, if pin C moves in the y direction, it's going to extend bar BC, and you have to subtract out, the movement of the pin B in the vertical direction. Now, I know what you're thinking, but pin B cannot move in the vertical direction. That's true, but hold on. We'll apply the boundary conditions. The trick is to apply the boundary conditions at the very end after you have done the minimization of potential energy. So that's how I hope that explains, how you get this term. What about AC, which is a little bit more complicated because it's inclined. So pi AC is going to be half KAC, and then you have to find the extension of AC in terms of the pins A and C. And then square it. Now let's say pin C moves in the vertical direction only. Okay, it moves like that. Of course, this is an exaggeration of the displacements. Now we can decompose that into a component along AC and perpendicular to AC, okay, something like that. And the component, by this reasoning, cannot, the component perpendicular cannot affect the potential energy, so we need to find only the component along AC, and if this is theta, then you can show from trigonometry that that's theta, and so you have UCY sine theta. So you see only part of the displacement of pin C in the vertical direction will affect AC. And you have to subtract out what pin A is doing in the vertical when it moves in the vertical direction. But then if pin C moves in the horizontal direction, that's going to have a component along AC, and so that's also going to affect the potential energy. So you have to also account for the motion of pin C in the x direction, and then that's going to be, you know, cosine theta component. I may get some of the mathematical details wrong, and you know, that's not important at this stage. What we really need to know is have a strong conceptual understanding of how kind of things come about. So we have expressed the potential energy, you know, the various terms in terms of the pin displacement. Similarly, you can do it for AB. I won't do it over here. This sets the stage for minimization of the potential energy and derivation of the algebraic equations, which is, you know, the key thing in the finite element method is derivation of the algebraic equations relating neighboring nodal displacements. We'll take a look at that next.